So they went down to Bethel. The sons of the prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord is taking your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Be quiet." And Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here because the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As surely as the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. And the sons of the prophets who were in Jericho approached Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord is taking your master away from you?" He said, "Yes, I know. Be quiet." And Elijah said to him, "Stay here because the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As surely as the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you." So the two of them went out. Then 50 men from the sons of the prophet came and stood and watched them from a distance, while the two of them were standing at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, folded it together, and struck the water. Water divided to the right and to the left. Then the two of them crossed on dry land. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask me for whatever I can do for you before I am taken from you." Then Elisha said, "Let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." He said, "You have asked for a difficult thing. If you see me being taken from you, it will surely be yours. But if not, then it will not." While they were walking and talking, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire came and separated them. So Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha was watching and crying out, my father, Israel's chariots and his charioteers." And they did not see him anymore. Here ends our reading. We continue with our Psalm 148. Join us singing it together.
Thank you.
keep them from clearly seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is God's image. Indeed, we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For the God who said, light will shine out of darkness, is the same one who made light shine in our hearts, to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the person of Jesus Christ. We hold this treasure in clay jars to show that its extraordinary power is from us and not is from, excuse me, to show that its extraordinary power is from God and not from us. Here at the reading. Alleluia, a voice came from the cloud. This is my son whom I love. Listen to him. Alleluia. That transfigure was a magnificent verb applied only to Jesus and at one time in his life. Transfigure just means change. For example, a couple weeks ago I went and got a haircut and I came out of there transfigured. I was transfigured into a better looking guy. Transfigure is just a verb that just means change. That's all it means. You have to look at what else is told, what else is said in order to understand how transfiguration took place. And in this case, we heard it clearly from our gospel lesson today. Jesus turned white as a sheet, not his face, himself entirely. It showed his glory as true God. Why? Because shortly afterward, Jesus would begin that horrifying and terrible and sorrowful trip to the cross of Calvary. The three disciples who were with him on the Mount of Transfiguration would have an amazing experience that they would later be able to tell, like they did in our gospel lesson. They would tell of the power, the majesty, the brightness, the glory of Jesus, so that they could recognize that this guy on the cross, who looked defeated, who looked like his enemies had won, they could think back to see the real glory of Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. Amazing. And on that Mount of Transfiguration, a veil was open to see the true glory of Jesus. But what about today? Can people clearly see the glory of Jesus? Paul writes, even if our gospel is veiled, that just means covered up. Covered up, not able to be seen. Remember, there were several veils in Scripture between different parts of the temple to block the view of people from the most holy place. The veil of Moses when he came down from the mountain so that people couldn't see the glory of God dissipate in his face. A veil is over the eyes of people. It is veiled among those who are perishing. In the case of those people, the God of this age has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from clearly seeing the light of the gospel and the glory of Christ, who is God's image. Remember the third article? The explanation of the third article of the Apostles' Creed? In her catechism learning, I believe that I cannot by my own thinking or choosing believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him. Right? I can't do it on my own. The Holy Spirit has to open our eyes to see the glorious message of Jesus Christ and the glorious message of the gospel. The gospel that saves us, that strengthens us, that encourages us. You remember how the Holy Spirit does his work, right? What does he use to do his work? I heard only one voice. The means of grace. What are the means of grace? Word and sacraments. How many sacraments are there?
Two.
What are they? Baptism and the Lord's Supper, right? Let's try again. What does the Holy Spirit use to do his work? The means of grace. What are the means of grace? Word and sacraments. How many sacraments are there? Two. What are they? Baptism and the Lord's Supper. One more time. This morning, he keeps wanting to mess me up. Was the Holy Spirit used to do his work?
Means of grace.
What are the means of grace?
Word and sacraments.
How many sacraments are there?
Two.
What are they?
Baptism and the Lord's Supper.
Doesn't matter whether we're talking about coming to faith, being strengthened in faith, being upheld in our faith. The Holy Spirit is the one that does it for us. The God of this age has blinded the people of this world. Who's the God of this age? The devil, right? He has blinded us He blinded Eve to see the truth. He blinded people throughout the history of the world to keep them away from Jesus. He blinded the people in Jesus' day from seeing who he really was. Instead, the devil got me when I exhibit anger. He blinds me when I don't treat my wife with the respect that she deserves. He blinds me when I say things I shouldn't say, either about people or those words that come too easily off my lips as a sinner. The devil blinds us. He puts a veil over everything that Christ has done and makes me think that somehow, if I'm good enough, I can save myself. I can do enough good to be in heaven. You want to see some blindness? Look at the impeachment hearings this past week. Doesn't matter what side you're on. One side didn't believe anything the other side said. The opposite side didn't believe anything the other side said. They had veils over their eyes. I don't know what the truth is. By the time it was all done, I thought maybe I had inserted the bottom. I don't know. But the bottom line is, it all just changed. There was no real, it was unclear what was happening. We see what we want to see. Let me say that again. We see what we want to see. We see our goodness. We don't see our badness. We like to think of ourselves as good people, never as bad people. But you see, we're no different than the rest of this world. The devil tempts us. We are born sinners. Like us, we are born into this world blind to the gospel, blind over our sins, blind to our need for a Savior. The only one who helps us to see the truth is the work of the Holy Spirit, right? What does he do? He used to do his work?
Means of grace.
Oh, you can do that better. What does he used to do his work?
Means of grace.
Indeed, we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For the God who said, light will shine out of darkness, is the same one who made light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the person of Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus reveals himself to us. The veil has been lifted, and we can see the glory of the gospel. That's what transfiguration is. And that is our guide as we, in these coming weeks, journey through the season of Lent. The light shines in our hearts. Did you hear that word? You know these things today. Valentine's Day. Okay? I looked for just a plain red heart. I couldn't find it. But I found it! Which is good, except it says, be my Valentine. Remind us of the day. Let's talk about Valentine's Day for a minute. St. Valentine lived in the mid-200s, and he was killed as a martyr. You know why? Because he was encouraging people in love to get married. Why was that so bad? You see, the thing that was bad is that the Roman government would not let married men join in the army. They didn't want marriages to take place because it took away their list of available army people. And so they did away with it. Back in the 1500s, 14th and 15th centuries, the word love became involved. And in the 1700s in England, it became customary to give gifts at Valentine's Day. Raise your hand if you've given any gifts for Valentine's Day. Oh, never mind, you people. We haven't been. Yeah, my wife is going to get this. Well, the trouble is, she's already seen it. You know, so it's going to be a surprise for her. But today, guess who's at our house? It's Jesus. The best Valentine we could ever have. The one who shows us what real love is. The one who says, I love you so much, dear Valentine, that I'm going to give my life for you on the cross. That I have given my life for you on the cross. I came to this earth for you. I suffered for you. I died for you. And I rose for you. I am the best Valentine we can ever have. That's Jesus. The best Valentine ever. Jesus has lifted the veil so that we can see his glory, the glory of Jesus and the gospel. Now we get to unveil him to the world. The last verse of our reading, we hold this treasure in clay jars to show that extraordinary power is from God and not from us. Now Paul, in the midst of humility, is saying what we all believe. We are like jars of clay holding the treasure of the gospel. Now, I'm not talking about the beautiful pottery, that you see on Antiques Roadshow, you know, where somebody finds this in their attic and it's worth $2 million, you know? I'm not talking about that kind of clay pots. We're talking about those cheap red clay pots that get broken all the time that aren't worth anything. But what do they hold? This lousy, worthless clay pot will hold a beautiful, gorgeous, fragrant rose. It holds something great. It holds something amazing. And we are the clay pots of Jesus, the clay pots of the gospel that hold the wonderful message of Jesus Christ in our hearts, share it in our lives, and live it every day of our lives. Those who share the gospel are not treasures themselves, but they carry and share the valuable treasure of Jesus Christ. You and I are not valuable parts of the gospel. We're like cracked pots, flawed, sinful, faulty, but we hold the treasures of the gospel in our hearts and lives. We are not good. We are rotten, lousy sinners. And yet God gives us the responsibility and the joy of holding the gospel in our hearts and sharing it in our lives. At some point in time, we're going to be installing a new pastor. Guess what? Your new pastor is not going to be any more perfect than any of you or me. Huh? You're going to want him to say all the right stuff at all the right times. You're going to want him to be a faithful leader, but a humble servant. You're going to want him to be everything to everybody in the congregation and never say anything that's going to hurt anybody's feelings. First of all, sometimes he's going to say things that he's supposed to say, that he should say. And that's called preaching the law. People aren't going to like it. You're not going to like it. And certainly some people especially are not going to like it, but it doesn't matter. He won't do it perfectly. And he won't always say the words in the right way. And he won't always be what you want him to be. Because you know what? He's just a clay pot. A cracked pot like you and like me. He's going to have shortfalls. Don't expect perfection. But do remember the wonderful phrase that somebody wrote. In spite of us being clay pots, the gospel still gets done. And so the faithfulness that you will want from your pastor, you want it to be faithful. Not perfect, but faithful. And that faithfulness also needs to be in us. We need to enjoy the light of the gospel. We need to share it every day of our lives. And we need to let the world see the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our own lives, our own words, our own actions. We continue now by confessing our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life.